sensitive. It means wise. Prudent means able to evaluate and make good decisions. For example, if I go to the store and I see a store label, double emphasis there. The folly of fools. If I'm foolish, I'm easily fooled. I'm easily deceived. I'm gullible. I can't make decisions. Right. I'm ignorant. I'm not able to make a decision for myself. I can be scammed. Easily victimized. All of us can be scammed. I've experienced a scam myself. I'll never forget. I lost $150 in college. eBay. I saw a computer for sale. Brand new laptop for $150. Oh boy. I needed a laptop. I had $150. So, I sent some of your email address, whatever, I sent it off. And I waited, 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 and I'm still waiting. I'm still waiting. I called the college yesterday. Is my computer there? No. Just kidding. It's a scam. I was taken in, but the most easily fooled. My friend in Michigan, he sent me a Facebook post. Christians on $1 million for the glory of God. Blah, 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 blah. I said, what? And I texted him and said, I'm sorry. People really believe this. This is something new. And they are gullible. And easily fueled. You try this and it doesn't work. Okay, so here we are. verse 9. Now more than ever, fools make a mockery at sin. The world doesn't care about sin. They sin openly. They sin and they with no shame. And they don't care. So what? I can do what I enjoy. There is no morality. It's my right, and I don't care. Because nobody believes in the Bible. They don't believe in the Bible. Because they don't believe in the Bible, they don't care. Say what? They say, why should I follow this? No. What do these rules have to do with me? I can smoke pot if I want to. I can do drugs if I want to. I can have sex if I want to. Whatever I want, I can do. I can do whatever I want, and there's no limit. In America, there are no laws against having drugs are now more and more available. It's not as clear as it used to be between right and wrong. It's now become a gray area, and church and many churches won't help. They won't preach against sin. God loves you. God will take care of you. God is merciful. God has grace. Yes, that's true. But he has justice, and he has principles that we have to follow. And if we ignore the law of God, we ignore his power, we ignore his word, we're fools. But among the righteous, there is favor. What does this mean? Favor. What does that mean? Something to support. Favor from who? From the Lord. Do you want help in your life? Do you want God to look down on you and be happy with you? And like what you're doing? I want God to like me. I want God to be pleased with me. I want him to say, you're my favorite. The Bible calls us his children. I'm a child of the King. Joint heir. What does that mean? It means, who's the Son of God? Son of God. I am a child of God, a joint heir with Jesus. I receive what he has because he has given it to me. That's the favor of God. The world doesn't have that. And they say it's not fair. Well, I chose to take the stand of righteousness. Right, I'm the only one who's the Son of God. No, we all. Who's lost their husband before and understands what the world is going through? Lula's experience would be a little bit different than hers. A little bit different than Maureen's. A little bit different from everyone has a little bit different experience. Nobody else can really understand what you feel inside. And counselors can make thousands of dollars trying to help you understand how you feel. Their job is to make you understand yourself and how you feel. You can tell them everything, but they have to help you figure out how you feel and why. Helping through figuring out how you're going to deal with this. Because not only is you that has to deal with it, I can't fix you. Speaking words of encouragement to her, praying with her, weeping with her. And I feel for her. I try my best to support her. But only the heart knows what it's going through. It's a terrible time. And at the same time, only you can feel. I mean, I think it turned off because it timed out. Turn it back on. It helped both of them come back on. Okay? So, that's really what this post means. Let's go. Okay, so I have to go back over here. Oh, okay, sorry. Verse 11.
No technical difficulty, that's okay. What?
Baseball bat to it. Now, verse 11. This is interesting. You see, verse 11. Why are we comparing the king? And I just talked about this last Wednesday, or a while ago, on Wednesday night. We talked about it. Both the same. Which one had the better kings? Judah, obviously. There was only one king, there was only one who wore the wine in Judah. The throne did not change hands very much. But in Israel, there were several families that took over the throne throughout its history. It was a mess. The house of the wicked shall be overthrown. They will lose their power. About England, you know, the queen just died. Now they have a new king, King Charles III. He's almost 73, but the line of kingship of England has been long. Will it one day be overthrown? I doubt it, because we'll see what happens. More and more, I doubt it. He doesn't have any power, right? He's not the governor. He doesn't have any power. So it's interesting when we think about the royal line. Solomon was writing this, and his line was strong, not perfect, he had problems, but in the north there were many more problems because the kings were terrible. And it's sad to see. And the same is true in your life. If you want the blessings of God in your life, if you're wicked, your house will be overthrown. So think about that. The tabernacle, but the tabernacle, and this word doesn't mean tabernacle or temple or church, it means your living place. Your living place. The tabernacle of the upright shall flourish. You will succeed and prosper. Even if you're poor, you can be poor and still be successful. And you can be rich and you can be a wreck. So I love verse 12. Proverbs 12. The key word here. What's the key word here? Seems. Seems. It seems right. If I'm walking on a path and I come to a turn, that seems like the right way. I think it is. I feel like it. If I'm the wise man, it seems okay. I walk along. It leads to death. It seemed okay. It seemed all right. I thought that was the right way. I wonder what God would say. This depends on your own wisdom, depending on the Lord. That's the key to verse 12. Do you depend on yourself and go do what seems right to you? You'll fall. You could break your leg. If you pay attention to the Lord and say, Lord, tell me how I should go. That's a hard way. This is an easier way. But I'll fall. It looks better. It looks right. It looks easier. But be careful. Make sure that the Lord is involved. Verse 13. Even in laughter, the heart is sorrowful, or sad, or grieving. It's a good way to explain it. How many of you have experienced this? I've experienced it so many times I can't tell you. You go to a funeral. Is a funeral a happy funeral or a sad funeral? Usually it's sad. And I have seen over and over again when a funeral is both the lost people and the saved people. You go to the funeral and you go to eat. They talk and they laugh. They are happy. So, can you laugh when your heart is sad? Yes. Solomon's point is, even though you look on the outside like you're smiling and laughing, inside you may still be sorrowful. You may still be struggling. Today, we call it masking. The world was struggling. And when he killed himself, people were confused. They didn't understand. They thought he was happy. He was always smiling and laughing. But inside, he struggled with depression and heartbreak. So it seemed like there was a conflict, and people didn't know what had happened. Why? The easy answer was he didn't have Jesus. And the world said, oh no. He had too many problems inside. He had scars. He had all of these things wrong with him. Okay, maybe. But really, it's pretty simple. He didn't have the Lord. If you don't have the Lord, you're going to struggle more. That's it, period. I've seen it, this over and over again. Famous people who aren't happy. They have money, they have a wonderful life, they have wonderful opportunities. They meet other famous people, but they're not happy. There's no happiness. That you can depend on the Lord, you can depend on yourself. Verse 12. Can you depend on yourself or the Lord? That's a simple answer. Verse 14. The backslider in heart shall be filled with his own ways, and a good man shall be satisfied from himself. Desires lead you astray. And you follow it, what's the result? What does this mean? Be filled with your own ways. More. down, and you're going further and further astray. You'll never be satisfied. Yes, I finally got the good one. No, you never have that feeling. You always want to try again because you want this and you want it so bad. How good it feels when you get it, you always want more. And look how far astray you've gone. And it's hard to come back. Not impossible, but it's hard. A good man shall be satisfied with whatever he has. Whatever he has. Full stop. I have learned, Paul said, I have learned to be satisfied with whatever I have. I may be up, I may be down, I may be rich, I may be poor, I may be broke, I may be beaten, I may be in good shape, I may be stable, but I'm happy with whatever I have. They're never satisfied. Let's close with prayer. Our Father in heaven, I thank you for the word from Proverbs, the book of wisdom. I pray that we apply your word to our lives every day. We read through it. Your word is full of wisdom. One verse a day we can apply to our lives. Prepare our hearts for the Lord's Supper and the service next. Help us to be ready to remember your death, and then also as I preach your word.